special welcome to our folks watching at home online this morning. Would y'all put your hands together for people watching online? Come on, make sure they can hear you. All right, that's awesome. Well, it's always a blessing to bring the Word of God on a Sunday morning, and today is no different. We're going to get started in a brand new sermon series on the book of Proverbs, and I'm excited to see how God moves in this series. We saw in the Prodigal Prophet series we just came out of how God really spoke to our people, not just individually, but as a church last week as we all came together to pray for those God has put on our hearts to share the gospel with. And I truly believe God's going to do something incredible with this series as well. And so rather than starting back in 700 BC, back around the time when this book was written, I actually want to start in the year 2006. I know most of us were alive and we're old enough to remember that monumental moment that changed the world in 2006, right? No? Come on, guys, this is only 15 years ago. There was a monumental moment that changed the way that the world would send and receive information, the way the world would acquire knowledge. I'm talking about the public launch of Twitter. Okay, I know you're laughing a little bit, but seriously, Twitter was more than just, it is more than just this social media phenomenon. Twitter quickly began impacting the way that our news was delivered, the way our news would be digested, right? The way we would acquire knowledge, the way our influence would be received by people. And it really began, or it fast-tracked this movement in our society towards knowledge and away from wisdom. So almost 3,000 years after Solomon inked these beautiful words that we read and we're going to hear today in the book of Proverbs, there was this social media platform with a little blue bird that came and disrupted all of that. All of a sudden, wisdom kind of went out the window, right? It's debatable as to whether or not wisdom was really even a priority before then, but definitely it's not now. I mean, content, as they say, is king, right? So knowledge reigns supreme. Of course, we all know that 2006 was really just the tip of the iceberg, right? Because after Twitter launched, Facebook had to respond. So what did they do? They put this news feed up. I don't know if you guys remember this, right? Our lives have changed completely since. I mean, how many of us could live without grandma's favorite cat memes, right? I mean, how many of us now get our news not from credentialed, you know, journalists, but from our buddy from high school who failed his U.S. history class, right? It's completely changed the way that we receive information. And over the past couple of decades, we've just been inundated with more and more platforms and media outlets and devices that are all designed just to overload us with information. I mean, we have personal robot assistants in our living rooms. And as much as I love Alexa, like, we don't need more information. What we need to know is what to do with this information, what to do with this knowledge that we have. And that's where wisdom comes in. That's why wisdom is so important, because knowledge, it can only get us so far. I love the way the great Charles Spurgeon talked about the difference between knowledge and wisdom. I've got this quote we're going to put on the screen here. It says, "Wisdom is the right use of knowledge. To know is not to be wise. Many men know a great deal, and they're all the greater fools for it. There is no fool so great a fool as a knowing fool. But to know how to use knowledge is to have wisdom." Right? The truth is, like, we have no shortage of knowledge today. What we lack is wisdom. Knowing how to use our knowledge, right? The ability to practically apply our knowledge, that's what we're lacking. Let me drive home the difference between these two. Okay, so knowledge builds the Titanic, but wisdom is knowing how to avoid the iceberg. Are you with me? I like this one. This one for married couples. Married couples out there, knowledge is knowing what to say. Wisdom is knowing whether or not to say it. I think I just saved an argument on the way home for some of you. Here's my favorite one. It's that knowledge knows a tomato is a fruit. Wisdom is not putting it in a fruit salad. You with me? I think it's so important for us to understand this idea between knowledge and wisdom so that we know what it is that we're really looking for. Because in today's day and age, it can be easy to mistake knowledge for wisdom. Knowledge may seem like wisdom, but it's kind of like fool's gold, right? It just looks like it. It's not as valuable as wisdom. And King Solomon, who wrote most of the book of Proverbs, he got this. And that's why he uses this Hebrew word, chokmah, for wisdom. Because chokmah literally means this applied knowledge. This idea of putting your knowledge to use in a meaningful way. In ancient Israel, this word chokmah actually wasn't even used to describe like educated people. It was used to describe the artists and the craftsmen, people who actually applied their knowledge, put meaningful use to it, to their craft. But this shift from knowledge to wisdom isn't just about application, right? There's something else there. I think we all know that. Because in order to find true wisdom, what we have to do is we have to connect with our Creator. We have to connect to the true source of wisdom. You know, the late Billy Graham, he put it this way. He said, knowledge is horizontal, but wisdom is vertical. Knowledge is horizontal, but wisdom is vertical. Like, we can keep gathering all this knowledge. We can go horizontal all day as much as we want. But in order to get wisdom, we have to go vertical. We have to connect with our Creator. I think that's such an important distinction because even in our relationship with God, we have a tendency towards knowledge, right? We want to know who God is. We want to know who God is, but in order to understand what He wants from us, we have to seek wisdom. We have to go beyond our understanding to connect with Him, to walk with Him. In fact, we just wrapped up this series on Jonah where we saw this out of Jonah's life, right? Jonah was a prophet of God. Right? He had this knowledge of God. He knew who God was. He knew what God wanted from him, but what he lacked was wisdom. He didn't apply that knowledge. And so instead of walking with God, he chose instead to run from him. But thank goodness we serve a God who pursues us, right? And just like he pursued Jonah, he wants to walk with us. So my hope and my prayer for each of you is that as we spend time in the book of Proverbs over these next few weeks is that you wouldn't come in here with this expectation of just learning about God and then leaving and going on about your week. My hope is that you would leave with this understanding of who he is because you're walking with God. Would you have an expectation to receive wisdom from God through his word this morning? Would you pray with me? Father, we thank you for your wisdom this morning. We thank you for the joy of knowing you, God, and for the invitation you've given each of us to walk with you, to grow in our wisdom, God, as we grow closer to you. Father, I ask that you would give me the words to bring your wisdom to life this morning for your children, God. Would you use your word to guide us, and would you receive all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise? It's in Jesus' name we pray, and all God's people said, amen, amen. Amen. Well, when I was a kid, probably about 8 or 9 years old, I was obsessed with reading. And I loved these books called Goosebumps. Any other Goosebumps fans out there? Couple other nerds like me? Okay, awesome. Well, for those of you who don't know about Goosebumps, Goosebumps are these kind of scary stories written for kids, right? The kids love them, yeah. And normally they'd be about like a haunted house or like this ventriloquist dummy come to life, you know, standard scary story stuff. I love these books. I had probably the first 40 of them, and I would read them over and over and over again. But I remember there was one day where this different kind of Goosebumps came out. It was this one right here, where you get to choose your own adventure. Some of you have probably read other books like this, where you come to a point in the story, and it stops, and then you basically get to choose between this decision or that decision, and it tells you what page to choose from. Right? This book has about 20 possible endings, and when you read it, you never know which decision is going to be your last. It's honestly slightly terrifying, even still as an adult. But isn't it true that we sometimes see life this way? Like, there's these crucial decisions, and we're left with choosing between these two doors, right? As if one is going to lead us to our happily ever after, and the other one is going to end with us being eaten by a werewolf or something, right? Well, when I was little, I would just flip ahead in the book. I'd cheat. I'd go into the future a little bit and be like, oh, I don't like that ending. I'm going to go backwards. But we don't have that luxury in life now, do we? So when we're faced with the decision about a job or a relationship or some other potentially life-altering decision, what do we do? Right? How do we know the right decision to make? How do we know which door to walk through? And for some of you, that can be a frightening and even paralyzing decision. But if that's you, I want you to know that there is hope. There is hope to be found, but that hope begins with you shifting your mindset away from this idea that life is some never-ending series of risky doors to choose from, and to view your life instead as a path to be traveled, right? To fix your eyes on your destination and to allow your direction to determine your decisions. Does that make sense? Because if you're simply taking life one decision at a time, and there's no clear direction, there's no destination in mind, then one day you're going to look up and wonder how the heck you got to where you're at and where the heck you are. Right? That's what we see in midlife crises all the time. All of a sudden, people kind of have the blinders lift and they realize, where am I and how did I get here? It's because they let their decisions determine their direction and not the other way around. Life is a pathway, my friends, which means we must have a destination in mind and we must rely on wisdom to get us there. So as we get ready to dive into the book of Proverbs, can I ask you just to shift your mindset? If you have a big decision you're about ready to make in life, I need you to step back and to look beyond that decision. Don't just see life as that series of never-ending doors to choose from. You've got to see it as a path. I truly believe God has a word for you this morning about this path that you're on. And I believe he wants to grant you the wisdom to know not just the best decision to make, but the best direction to take. Right? One that's going to align you with his will. One that's going to lead you towards the purpose that he has for your life. So if you have your Bibles or your Bible apps, I want to invite you to turn with me to Proverbs chapter 4. We're going to get ready to read the words of the wise King Solomon. Now just so you know, Solomon was no ordinary king. Solomon was King David's son. And it's said that he was the wisest man to ever live. In fact, in 1 Kings, it tells us that he was wiser than all of Egypt combined, that people would come from all over. Other kings would come from all over to hear his wisdom. And so if Solomon has something to say, you better be ready to listen because this right here is God-given wisdom. And so what we find in Proverbs is 31 chapters of straight truth. Now the majority of the book is filled with sayings that some of y'all are familiar with, right? Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. These great two-liners. Like train up your child in the way they should go. When they get older, they won't depart from it. But what we sometimes kind of gloss over is the first 9 chapters are about instruction. It's really Solomon guiding his children and ultimately guiding us on this path towards wisdom. So with that in mind, let's read Proverbs chapter 4, starting in verse 10. It says, "Hear, my son, and accept my words, that the years of your life may be many. I have taught you the way of wisdom. I have led you in the paths of uprightness. When you walk, your step will not be hampered, and if you run, you will not stumble. Keep hold of instruction. Do not let go. Guard her, for she is your life." Now, there's a theme that's running throughout this chapter. If you were to read the whole thing through, you would see 7 different times Solomon uses this idea of life being a path, life being this way. Right? And verse 11 calls out this path of uprightness. Other translations call it a straight path. In other words, an honest or a true path. And we see this imagery used all throughout Proverbs, actually. And I think what Solomon's trying to do is 2 things. One is he's trying to tell us, hey, life is that continual journey. It's not this series of doors to choose from. But 2nd is that following the will of God is much more about the direction that we take, not just the individual decisions that we make. So it's the direction of our lives that should be our focus. Because our directions dictate our decisions. Your directions dictate your decisions, and those decisions determine your destination. I want to encourage you, I don't know if you normally take notes, but if you don't, I want to encourage you to take some notes this morning. I do believe God has some wisdom for you, and so if you are taking notes, write this down. Point number 1 is your direction dictates your decisions. Now I'm curious, when you leave on a road trip with a friend or with your family, what are the first 2 things you need to figure out? Right, it's how am I going to get there? And where am I going to stop along the way? Right, those are the 2 decisions you need to figure out. Or if you have kids, it's what's the fastest way to get there and how many potty breaks you're going to have to take along the way, right? But the point is that life is like a road trip. So the direction that we want to head in is going to determine, it's going to dictate the decisions that we need to make along the way. And Proverbs 4 tells us those decisions, coupled with wisdom, are what get us to our destination. Right? Proverbs 4 tells us that we won't be hampered or held back. Right, that wisdom is what keeps us from stumbling along the way. Wisdom is what brings to mind the fact that we need to get the oil changed, that we need to check the tires before that road trip. Let me be clear, Proverbs 4 is not guaranteeing that we won't stumble. After all, these are proverbs, they're not promises. Hold on to that one for the next few weeks. These are proverbs, not promises. But what it's saying is that if we go down this path with the wisdom we have received, we will not be held back from the direction that God is sending us in. And I love how Proverbs 4, it sort of just assumes this forward motion, right? It says, when you walk, or if you run. There's no question as to whether or not we're moving forward. But yes, some of us still feel the need to sit and just wait until we hear the audible voice of God, until we're going to actually do something. I'm not saying that we shouldn't, you know, wait to hear from God, that we shouldn't try to hear from God, but if we're confident in the direction that he has us heading towards, we can allow our direction to dictate our decisions. We can and we should move forward with confidence. I want to give you an example. We'll take a look at Paul and his missionary journey. In Acts chapter 16, we see him on this missionary journey, right? And we see him go and he gets turned away by the Holy Spirit, not once, but twice. Right? Surely the apostle Paul would know exactly where God wants to send him, right? Wrong. It says he tries to go to Asia to share the gospel, and the Holy Spirit had forbidden it. And so he tries to go to Bithynia, but it says the Spirit of Jesus Christ stopped him. This is Paul we're talking about. He may not have been clearly hearing from God about where he was supposed to go, but he knew his direction. He knew that he was supposed to go and preach the gospel to the Gentiles. So he walked if he wanted to. He ran when he had to, but he got off his butt and he got moving. All the while, he was open to the Holy Spirit redirecting his route. I believe there are some of you that are here today and you know the direction that God has sent you in, and you just need to get off your butt and get moving. You see, we get this idea that God's supposed to reveal our plans, his plan for our life in some dramatic fashion. I've even heard some of you say, I'm waiting for that billboard. But God doesn't work that way, not always. Sometimes he does. Sometimes we see him in scripture and he'll have that big, you know, dramatic moment. But that's the exception. Paul had a dramatic encounter with Jesus on the road to Damascus, where Jesus gave him his direction. But then we see him in Acts 16, and he doesn't know exactly where to go. In fact, I'm going to show you one more example. In Acts chapter 15, Paul's actually with the other disciples talking about this missionary journey. I want you to pay attention to this language that's used. You could put Acts 15, 22 up on the screen. It says, then it seemed good to the apostles and the elders, and they chose some men to go with Paul and Barnabas. And later on, they're discussing the requirements for this journey. In Acts 15, 20, 28, it says, for it has seemed good to the Holy Spirit and to us. So here you have a group of guys that are risking their lives to share the gospel, making decisions because it seemed good. There was no certainty here for them. There was no dramatic revelation, just a group of guys who knew their direction, who knew the direction God had put them in, and allowed that to dictate their decisions. So how do they have such a peace about it, right? How do they have enough confidence to know that they can move forward? Well, it's because they had walked with Jesus. They were following Jesus in the sound of his voice, which gave them confidence in their direction and in those decisions. It's kind of like playing Marco Polo in the swimming pool. Everybody play Marco Polo? You know, and there's always the people that are kind of waiting around in the water with their eyes closed, and they yell Marco, and then the other person yells. Yeah, it's pretty good. I wasn't expecting that kind of cooperation. But even though that person may be blind to some of what's going on around them, if you were to pay careful attention to the sound of their voice, you're able to work your way closer and closer to them. That's kind of what it's like to live a life following after Jesus. We may not be able to see all of the things around us, but if we pay attention to the sound of his voice, we can know we're heading in the right direction. Because here's the deal, y'all, is that Jesus, he will be faithful to call out to us. We just have to have ears to hear. We have to have that desire to follow, and that's where wisdom comes in. When we're walking in wisdom, scripture tells us that it lights our path. It illuminates God's will for our lives, and it shows us the way to get there. But we have to have ears to hear. We have to have that desire to follow. Unfortunately, we're all sinful and selfish, aren't we? So we lean on our own knowledge and not on God's wisdom, because then we at least have some control over our lives, right? When we rely on our own knowledge, we can predict what's going to happen. But when we put our trust in God and his plan for our life, that's a whole other ballgame. That's a whole other risk to trust something outside of ourselves. So even though wisdom illuminates our path, even though that sounds nice and easy, the fact is that along our path, we're going to have opportunities to go off course. That's why Proverbs 4 warns us not to enter the path of the wicked. Verse 15 says, avoid it. Don't go on it. Turn away from it. Pass on from it. Don't be tempted to chase after knowledge. Stay on the path towards wisdom. Friends, just because we're walking on an honest path doesn't mean the enemy won't tempt us with some dishonest detours. We must let wisdom guide our path because, hear this, the enemy is crafty. The enemy is so crafty. I mean, I want you to think about this for 1 second. Have you ever thought about the open doors that you've prayed for? We've all prayed for that prayer, right? Lord, would you just open doors? I used to tell people that if God were to open the door, hey, I don't care what it is, I'm walking through it. But how do I know if it's God who opened that door? How can I know if it's God who opened that door? How do I know if it's the Lord's will or if it's the enemy's trap? I'm not trying to mess with you here, but we have to be careful because remember, when Jonah fled from God, there was already a boat there waiting to go to Tarshish. The enemy is always going to provide you an escape. He can open doors too. He is crafty. That's why we need wisdom in order to be able to discern which doors God's opening and which doors the enemy is opening. He's crafty enough to disguise doors, and he's crafty enough to do the old bait and switch too. I mean, how many of you ever made a decision because you felt peace about it? You felt like God gave you that peace. I want you to hear me when I say this, that God can and he will give you peace. But I don't want you to forget how peacefully Jonah slept on the boat in the middle of the storm. You know, the Bible doesn't promise us peace when God reveals our purpose. So we must use wisdom to check our hearts to see where that peace is coming from. Because I'm not saying God's not going to open doors. I'm not saying he won't give you peace, but we must know the voice of our Creator to know the difference. And the only way we can know his voice, hear this family, is by reading his word. Because the truth is, if you're reading his word, you're going to know whether that door is one that he opened or not. You'll know whether that peace comes from him or if it's from your own just blissful ignorance. The word of God becomes a filter through which you can make the decisions of your life. Wisdom becomes that filter for your life. So you don't need to have the big billboard. If you run those decisions through that filter of wisdom, through the filter of the Word of God, you can have confidence in the direction that you are heading. Leads me to point number two. If wisdom is a path, the next question you should be asking is, am I on the right path, right? Am I on the path towards wisdom? Well, that depends. Which direction are you headed in? Because your direction will determine your destination. It's point number two. Your direction will determine your destination. Look back with me at Proverbs 4. We're going to jump down to verses 26 and 27. It says, ponder the path of your feet, then all your ways will be sure. Do not swerve to the right or to the left. Turn your foot away from evil. Your direction, friends, determines your destination. Actually borrowed that line from a pastor named Andy Stanley, who said more specifically that your direction, not your intention, determines your destination. And that's why this verse focuses on the action of your feet and not just the goals that you have in your mind. Because how many of you know that you can walk in the opposite direction of your destination? Right? I see some of you out there saying one thing, right? Your mind's going this way and your feet are walking this way. You know, it's like saying, hey, I want to find that perfect person for me. I want to find my wife. And then you're out there dating anybody that swipes left or swipes right. I'm not sure which direction's the right way, honestly. Thank goodness. We started dating before those apps. Or how many of you are saying, hey, you know, family is the most important thing to me. My family first. And you're working 100 hours a week. Right? Or hey, it's time to get fiscally responsible. I'm going to save up for that house. I'm going to save up for that car. And then your credit card bill is going this way. Yeah. I mean, I can intend to go to Austin, but if I get on 35 going north, I'm never going to get there. Yeah. Church, your destination is determined by the path that you take. And your path is made up of the steps that you make. So you got to be pondering those steps daily. Because even if you're headed in the right direction, friends, you know how easy it is to get off course. I've probably heard this illustration before, but if you were to take off from New York City and head towards LA, and if you're even 1 degree off in your direction, by the time you get to Southern California, you're going to be 40 miles out into the Pacific Ocean. Your direction, not your intention, determines your destination. And the truth, friends, is that most of us here are in need of a redirect. Maybe you started your journey headed in the right direction, but you veered off course, and suddenly you find yourself this morning wondering, how the heck did I get to where I am? You can look back and see maybe some of the seemingly small decisions that took you off course. There may be some of you here this morning, you never set out in the right direction in the first place. Whatever it is, friends, it's time to get back on track this morning. It's time that we set ourselves in the right direction. But in order to do that, we must look inside our hearts. That brings me to my third and final point this morning as I invite the band back up. Point number three is your heart sets your direction. Proverbs 4, verse 23 says, "Guard your heart above all else, for it determines the course of your life." What Solomon's trying to tell us here is that we must be vigilant in the guarding of our heart because it is what drives us. It's what sets our direction. Proverbs 16:9 tells us that the heart of man plans his way. So long before we make any decisions or we set out towards that destination, our heart sets our direction. And Solomon, he uses this word, this Hebrew word for guarding. It's natsar, and it has this feeling of this continual watching. Kind of like a security guard would keep continual watch over something. Never letting his guard down and watching for two things. One is that toxic things wouldn't come in. There wouldn't be any attacks from the outside, but also to keep the good things from leaving, from being stolen away. It's important to keep our hearts pure from harm, yes, but we also must make sure that there is nothing stealing our affections from Jesus. And the best way to guard our hearts, church, is by being in the Word of God. Not only does the Word of God set our hearts in the right direction, but it guards our hearts from anything harmful getting in. It guards our hearts from letting any of the truth get out. Because here's the deal. It's our proximity to God and our familiarity with His Word that guards our hearts. Taking notes, write that down. Our proximity to God, our familiarity with His Word that protects our hearts. We see this in the very beginning. Adam and Eve in the garden. We see the importance of their proximity to God and their familiarity with His Word because I want you to notice when the enemy tempted them. They weren't walking with God. They weren't in close proximity to Him. And notice how the enemy tempted them. How the enemy tempted them. He said, did God really say? He questioned their familiarity with His Word. They weren't in close proximity to God. They weren't familiar with His Word, so their hearts weren't guarded. Because their hearts weren't guarded, it determined the course of their life and all of us that follow. But we know that's not the end of the story, right? We have 66 books here, and they all point to God's redemption plan, which was to come to earth, fully God and fully man. And I want you to see this in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 30. It tells us that this man, Christ Jesus, became to us, listen to this church, Christ Jesus became to us wisdom from God. You see, in the beginning, we chose knowledge over wisdom. They say wisdom is to walk with God. Well, they were literally walking with God in the garden. But still, they chose knowledge over wisdom, and they ate from the tree. God's intent was for us to grow in wisdom by walking with Him. And yet Adam and Eve do what we do all the time. We shortcut the process. We chase after knowledge. But I want you to notice what God did. God sent wisdom to pursue us. God's redemption plan was for Jesus to come, for wisdom to come in human form, so that we might once again walk in right relationship with God. Church, I need you to hear this. There is no wisdom outside of knowing Jesus. Jesus is wisdom. He is Proverbs in the flesh, which is why we say that we need Him in our hearts. We need Him to guide our steps. We need Him to set our direction and to be with us every step of the way. Friends, God has a purpose and a plan for your life. And the only way to discover our purpose, the only way for us to truly make a difference, is for us to walk with Jesus, for us to allow His Word, His voice, His wisdom to guide our hearts and to guide our steps. Listen, I don't know where you're at this morning, but if you're not in close proximity to God, if you're not familiar with His Word, then it's time to get back on track. It's time to stop chasing after knowledge. Time to stop leaning on your own understanding. and time to start trusting in the Lord and in His wisdom. So with every head bowed and every eye closed, I want to talk to those of you who feel like you may have gotten off track. You may feel like you lost your way, like the decisions that you've made have gotten you so far off course you couldn't possibly find your way back. I want you to know this morning, friends, it doesn't matter how far that you've gone or where you might have wound up. God is still pursuing you. His love, it knows no limits. There are no boundaries to His grace. If that's you this morning, I want you to know that God is with you. We, your church family, we are with you. We want to come alongside you because you weren't designed to walk this path of life alone. So, friends, if that's you this morning, if you're in need of prayer, if you're in need of somebody to walk through life with, would you just raise your hand right where you're at? Would you acknowledge the need for wisdom? For God and His community of people to get you back on track this morning. I see your hand raised. I see your hand raised, brother. I see your hand. We're a church that doesn't just say we're going to do this. We want to be there with you. We want to walk down this road with you. We want to do what Jesus did. Walk in this road with you. Father, we are so grateful for your word this morning. We're grateful that you love us so deeply and pursue us so relentlessly that you would send your son, not just to become wisdom to us, but to sacrifice his life for us so that we might once again walk with you. Lord, we are so undeserving of your grace, yet you choose to walk with us and to mold us into the image of your son. God, I pray that you continue speaking truth into our lives. That you continue to illuminate our path and give us the courage. And Father, give us the wisdom to follow where you are leading. Pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Just stand and worship with us as we close today's service.
Excuses not to sing, right? Let's sing it out. Cool.
This story has an empty grave. This story has an empty grave. Jesus, the process is a mystery, but your promise never fails. This story has an empty grave.
We'll walk through.
Everything's gonna be alright.
Yeah, amen. Lift up a shout of praise. He is so worthy. Thank you for coming and worshiping with me. May you go in the grace and peace of our Savior, Jesus. Be blessed.